It's fun. It's fun serving God. Hallelujah. This is abundant life. I had Ruth in, and I think it was Daniel put life equals fun. I'm going to tell you right now, abundant life equals abundant fun. Amen. You need to get ready, get yourself out of the equation. Things get much better. Get your own, you know, own interest out of it. Things get really good. And you're just living as a servant to do the will of the Father. It's just so good. And the doors that the Lord opens up, you just excited about. The doors that are closed, you just excited about. Amen. And you get so happy in God that you just actually have fun in the hard times. In all your tribulations, you're exceeding glad. I want you to come to know this kind of life in Christ Jesus rather than any other one. I want you to understand the biblical life in Christ Jesus. Why make it up as you go? Why have one that looks like somebody else, you know, that isn't really expressing what Christ Jesus has provided for us? Have one that the Word of God clearly defines. Grab a hold of the Word of God. Take hold of the Word of God. Doesn't matter what anybody said in any century. It is irrelevant. The Lord said it before they ever said it. Go to the source. Amen.
Amen.
I tell you, the Bible was written before Augustine had a comment. The Word of God was declared before Luther had a comment, before Calvin had a comment, before I've had a comment. Anyone. So go with God. You know, don't make it about the other things. Make it about a God thing. Hallelujah. So I'm going to talk to you about, tonight about how to grow and mature in the things of the Spirit. If it's a struggle, first of all, let me just say this. If it's a struggle, if it's hard to do, if you're hacking at it, and in it, you're going to have to just relax. If you got to produce it, if you got to make it happen, and in it, and in God, that's you. What Father does is an overwhelming flow. I mean, many times I get what you might refer to as drunk, simply because I'm not even operating in my own mind. Somebody might ask me right after the meeting, what did you say? I don't know. You gave me a word. I'm sorry, I don't know. Let's both go listen to the recording. And because the Holy Spirit would come into our life and will literally shut down all of our own agendas, all of our own thinking. There's so many times that I've set out to say something and the Lord said it in an entirely different way. I've thought something about a person, the Lord thinks it in an entirely different way. It's literally learning how not to walk after our own mind, our own thinking, our own understanding, our own considerations in any measure, but to hear what God the Holy Ghost is saying just because you yielded to Him. Now, I want to teach you how to get yielded to Him. I want to teach you how to bypass all your perceptions, all of your issues, where I don't care what happened to you when you were 3 years old. It's irrelevant. You know, to where that you become so beside yourself, you become so under the operation of the Holy Spirit, it's like your spirit shut down. And it's not that altogether, because if anybody who's listening to me tonight, maybe you might be listening with a bit of a critical ear. Hey, listen, our spirit, let me help you with that. That's what really helps you. Our spirit's made one with His Spirit. That's beautiful, isn't it?
Yes.
I think that a lot of people's theology would be corrected just on that one point alone. The reality of it is the Holy Spirit is allowed to move in our life in such a way that He fully takes over. He takes completely over. And now we get to function in the word of knowledge and the discerning of spirits. We get to function in His wisdom, His joy, His love. It's just beautiful. It's just beautiful. And the more you give yourself to this life, the stronger it becomes. Okay? Prayer is a beautiful thing. Prayer isn't about what you learned how to be. Many people who was raised in traditional churches, and that many people who even raised in Pentecostal churches, how they thought it to be, and then based on what they thought it to be, then they tried to do it out of that. No. Prayer is where you yield yourself to the Holy Spirit so that He can begin to be activated in your life and produce something through you. Woo! It's beautiful. And see, if I'm going to talk to you about interpretation of tongues, and if I'm going to talk to you about prophecy, you've got to learn this. And I can talk to you about it from this perspective. Remember when you sit down to pray, or you stood up to walk around to pray, and you really didn't have anything coming to you? It's like, oh, Lord, bless Uncle Joe, and bless Aunt Sally, and God bless Mom, and oh, God, help us to want something, and even though we don't know what we want. I mean, it just was dry, you know, you didn't know what to say. But then, as you begin to... Where it was beyond you? It was beyond you? It was beyond you? just interpret. See, there's a place where tongues and words actually phase in and out. They're almost under the same inspiration. They almost mingle together. That's the interpretation of tongues. Also can be the springboard of prophecy. Also can be the springboard of revelation. Beautiful. It's just the way it works. Revelation doesn't mean that I don't have to study the word anymore. But it doesn't mean I have to study either. Because Peter didn't understand by revelation what he was able to say, that this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, simply because he's been studying the millennial attributes of the kingdom of God versus the attributes of the church age before the millennial. He didn't. It was revelation. It came to him because he stepped into Dodobokodaya. He stepped into Namasiprabhata Kaniya Pakutayana. He stepped into Namapadanayata. And this is so important to learn. People think, well, I got to aspire to a level. No, you got to get the real thing. And then when you go to Makaniyashtahan, when you have an Kandamosiyata, an encounter with the Holy Spirit, in such a way where you baptize the Holy Ghost in fire, these things are downloaded in your spirit in a radical and in a very matured way that then grow and mature even more. Hallelujah. Now, and I'm not going to take away from just stammering lips. Because the can start off just as because I've watched that happen in people's life, and now they're embarrassed because all they've got is a and not a bokoravasiya. Don't worry, we'll bring you into something. Hallelujah! The Holy Ghost will take a and make it into these wonderful, diverse expressions of His presence being manifested through our life. Let me tell you something, some real simple things. When you begin to pray in the language of the Spirit, it's God praying and not you. Do you understand me? Are you convinced that when you speak in a heavenly language, it's God speaking? Are you convinced? Let me give you the proof text to start off with, just one good proof text just to begin with. And they all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Ha 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 ha. So, help break that down. Holy Ghost is God. He gave them the utterance. Thus, it is God speaking through them. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Pretty simple stuff, isn't it? Doesn't really get any more complicated than that. Hallelujah. Now, and then just to say, simply say this. Anytime you're straining and having a hard time begging God and wishing it was different, you ain't going to get nothing. Because that's doubt and unbelief. Forget it, you shut down. Because these things of the Spirit work over in a realm of thanksgiving and praise, and you're just so blessed, and you're just so overwhelmed, and it's something that's just flowing to you. Hallelujah. Somebody says, well, is there times that you would start off and it's a little bit awkward and it's a little bit challenging? Yeah, but you know what you ought to begin to do is just begin to praise the Lord. Just begin to give thanks. Say, Father, you're so wonderful. Jesus, you're so wonderful. Holy Ghost, you're so wonderful. I hope that's an easy prayer for you to remember. Is that what difficult? Just, I'm going to try it again. I'll rehearse it for you. Father, you're so wonderful. Jesus, you're so wonderful. Holy Spirit, you're so wonderful. If you all broken down, there's something wrong with that picture. That isn't joy unspeakable. Is there times where the Lord will just come on me with a thunderous thing? Yeah. I was just recently in a meeting with a bunch of pastors, and all of a sudden I had a thunderous tongue. And I pointed at one pastor and I said, come here. And as soon as he stood back by me, man, I tell you right now, I was taken a hold of by the power of God. I grabbed a hold of him. And I mean, I don't know, I might have hurt him physically. And I delivered the word of the Lord to him. Now, there's some things that happen. There's some unique things that happen. But where we're really, where we live at our life, where we live at our relationship with the Lord, is in the context of this wonderful joy and this wonderful peace. If prayer doesn't bring an overwhelming love and joy and peace into your life, there's something wrong with that prayer. Shut that bad boy down. Okay, pull the plug on that thing and don't allow it anymore. Say, you know what, I need to learn how to pray in a different way. Prayer, and people who have a hard time finding time to pray have never come into prayer. They don't understand yet. They've never really yielded themselves. They've got a misconception of it. Because prayer is an opportunity for you and I to let God flow through us. Prayer is an opportunity for us to have the moving of the power from on high that develops us into every beautiful thing that belongs to His life. It's heaven. And so when prayer becomes heaven, you're like, whoo, when do we get to do this? Okay? Everybody wants to do fun things. Nobody wants to do boring things. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Prayer is not supposed to be boring. Okay? And so I said, well, I put a time clock on it. I put a quality clock on it. You know what? I pray till I hit heaven and that don't take long, and then I just stay in heaven so long as I want to. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
And there's many times. I was telling a preacher yesterday, I said, man, I'm having a hard time telling when the anointing's on some things because I'm so living in such a fiery anointing that it's like, you know what? I can tell when the anointing's not on something. Can you hear what I'm saying? And you say, well, you bragging. Well, I'm bragging on God and I'm bragging on the relationship. And I'm going to be an example of, hey, look, it's good over here. Come get in. Because really, you know, when we read the Word of God and we read about Enoch and we read about Abraham and we read about Jacob and we read about Moses and we read about Elijah, they're just witnesses saying, hey, this realm really does exist. You guys are missing out. Get in over here. And so with this is the Word of God, the Spirit of God begins to stir up hunger and go in our spirit and go, I want to live in that realm. And then we start getting a desire to live in that realm. Then the Lord starts showing us what's necessary to live in that realm. What do we got to do to live in that realm? Because you could say, well, the sovereign act of divine grace came upon them and gave them the ability to be who they were in God. Well, that's true. But the same sovereign power has come upon you and given you a grace to be all these things in God and actually even more. Hallelujah. Now, what you got to understand is the things that run interference with that, the things that block that, the things that distract you from that, the things that you allow to be emotional impacts on your life that should not be. Your heart, you should give your heart with all diligence. I mean, come on. And where that you have no emotional impacts at all, where you just don't get into strife, you don't get into argument, you don't get into the complaint. I mean, have you ever tried to spend a day with a person who's a complainer? Give me a break. Just moaning all the time. You know, it's just like, please go talk to the tree. You know, there's squirrels that may be interested. But me, God, I know God's not interested. He's done shut you down because he doesn't have, he says, I swore my wrath. I'm told the work was finished from the foundation of the world. You're not coming into my rest because you're murmuring and complaining. Because murmuring and complaining is also hooked up strongly with unbelief. You can only murmur and complain because you don't believe. You got over into doubt and unbelief and you shut God down from being God. You're upset with the way he's treating you. You're upset with the way things are going on in your life. And you just basically wrote him out of the picture so you could moan and groan and murmur and complain for a little while. Enjoy your demonic, you know, whatever. Because, you know, because that's where it's going to end up. And I pray that no one has such an enjoyment in their life. I pray whether you would rather stay over here, and this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, that you give thanks in all things. And God the Holy Spirit has come to give us the privilege and the ability to give thanks most excellently. When you see the interpretation of what they were what was actually going on as they on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 and verse 10, they were praising God. They were describing how wonderful he is. That's what they were saying. That's what everybody was hearing in their own language. When you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, the scripture tells us, Paul tells us, that the unlearned won't be able to say amen at your giving of thanks, even though you give thanks most excellently. People, God wants you to learn how to give thanks. And what happens is he wants you to learn how to give thanks all the time. I've never experienced manifest presence of the Lord complaining. Saying, oh God, what's wrong with me? I've never gotten anything. It just gets, it's a spiral, you know. It's in a ditch and you're still digging. You know, it's just start praising him. Just start thinking. If you can't think of anything else, think him for that your name is written in the book of life, Lamb's book of life. Maybe you don't even believe that at that moment. Just thank Him for your pillow. Thank you that you have feet to stand on and that your voice is actually working. Whatever, start somewhere. And then, well, I pray that you never get to a place where you're not in doubt. I pray you never get to a place where you're in doubt whether or not your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. Whew. Hallelujah. So I want you to look at a couple of verses of Scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. So just open up your Bibles there, because I want to set some premises. I want to set the basis here for some of the things that I want to say to you. Once again, can you remember this? If you don't remember anything else leaving here tonight, remember, prayer time is a time that you give the Holy Spirit opportunity to flow through you and express His glory and His will through you. So that, and the more you give time to Him being able to take over and express His will and His glory through you, the stronger it becomes. So enjoy. Enjoy. I don't know what else you've been doing. Somebody said, I pump weight. Well, why don't you quit doing that? Start pumping some spirit. You know what I'm saying? Because bodily exercise profits little, but godliness has great profit to us. And I don't know, I know of nothing greater to define godliness than flowing in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Whew. So, in hallelujah. You know, you open up this chapter in verse 2. It said, he that speaks in an unknown tongue, or he that allows God to speak through him. Amen. Because they all spake in tongues. The Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Speaks not unto men, but unto God. And what he's doing is he's speaking unknown things in the Spirit. Unknown things. Hallelujah. God the Holy Ghost speaking unknown things that are all about you and all about what God wants to do through your life and all about who God is. And he wants to turn that into expressions that you know. So it's not unknown. It's not a mystery anymore. It's revelation. And really, the excelling into the interpretation of tongues should be easier than actually having the first experience of tongues. I mean, you, after God the Holy Ghost is allowed to speak through you, most of the problems should have already been solved. Most of the doubt barriers should have already been broken. Most of the yieldingness issues should have already been taken care of. Now it's just all downhill from here. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so should prophecy flow. But you know what? God the Holy Spirit wants to take hold of. God wants to take hold of your emotions, and he wants to take a hold of your attitudes and your passions. I see people pray all the time, and God didn't get their emotions, and God didn't get their passions, and God didn't get their attitudes. It just didn't happen that way. They stayed right in their same emotion, their same attitude, their same issues, their same problems. They were right. They stayed right in it, okay? They didn't change. Well, it's because they never made a transition from the realm of self, the realm of their own concerns and their own issues, into the realm where God the Holy Ghost takes over, and now you just basically experiencing the things that he wants to supply to us. You know what he wants to supply to us? How he feels. His disposition, his nature, his character. And because he gave us a new spirit, a new heart, because Christ Jesus has been formed in us, it should be the easiest thing for us to hook up with and then continually stay in. And so Jesus told us about all the snags that if you don't watch out for them, they're going to pull you more to living over in a natural realm, in a natural life, tending to the things of yourself more than the things of heaven. And he said, you're in jeopardy of ever making heaven over there. And he said it over and again, but people don't hear it because they've already got other ideas about life. They've other people in the culture and the society and, you know, significant people have already set precedents for them, what was very important for them to do, and they're very comfortable there, so they never really know how to go on. And they're frustrated. They don't know how to go on until a crisis happens. And I pray a crisis happens to you tonight. It's a hunger crisis.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Some of you really responded powerfully on Wednesday night. Some of you really responded in a powerful way on Wednesday night. You responded to the Lord. A man of God who has a great prophetic anointing calls me up the next day. He said, had a radical dream about the abiding place last night. He said, "This." He said, "I haven't got it all worked out yet, but I'm going to lay it on you, man, so you help me understand this thing." He said, "I came into the meeting and I said, surrender everything to the Lord." He said, "You know those big old shopping crates that are metal that you have at Costco, the big flat ones?" He said, "It was stacked already up to the handle high with stacks of money, and people were throwing more on it." I said, "Yeah, because what's happening is money represents the heart. And when you say, I surrender all, there's nothing that more represents the I surrender all than the money." And for me, that was just the Lord just giving by witness of another person some of the responses that was in your heart. Look at meetings like that are set up in heaven. You say, "Oh, can we have a meeting like that tonight?" You have to ask the Father. He's the one who's in charge. He gives us opportunities. He gives us divine opportunities. That's why, understand me. You don't want to miss your divine opportunity every day, because I'm still on the issue of prayer. I'm still on the issue of growing so you can understand how to function and flow in tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecy, revelation, knowledge, doctrine. That's why when Evan Roberts went to his pastor and he said, "What do I got to do to be in one of these great revivals?" Because in Wells, you could almost put it by the calendar. About every 40 years, another great sovereign moving of God would take place. And fortunately, during the time of Evan Roberts, and really under, you could say, the leadership of Evan Roberts, probably the greatest move of God in Wells took place in his ministry. And there was a great hunger in his life. And as a young man, he goes to his pastor, he says, "What do I got to do to be in one of these great sovereign moves of God?" He said, "Just be in the meeting every time. Because you do not know when God's going to move. You've got to set God first. You've got to set church first. You don't know. Because the Father's going to come at a time when you least think. He's going to come at a time when you least expect it. Guess when you didn't go to the meeting? When you least expected God to do anything. Something else got prioritized." You don't understand this. One of the greatest moves of God that has ever taken place in modern times took place because somebody took that to heart and they set the kingdom of God first and they set this opportunity of meeting with God first. You need to do this because the Holy Ghost knows. He knows. He knows how serious you are. He knows how hungry you are. And he's so merciful because when we're insincere and we deprioritize him, he still loves us. You know, if you deprioritize me, you know, or if I deprioritize the Holy Ghost as I have deprioritized him at times, I would probably not want to be my friend anymore. You know what I'm saying? When I already tell him you're first, right? And this is a relationship that's almost like a marriage relationship. It's a covenant relationship. And besides that, you're God. I'm not. You come here. You're willing to be my teacher. You're willing to be my mentor. You're willing to be my lead. You're willing to be my guide. And now I've made some little peanut a priority over you. You know, I made a speck of dirt. I made some temporal. You're listening to me. God sees this stuff. We act like he doesn't see. He sees. We act like he doesn't know. He knows. We make up all these ideas in our mind as to why things worked out the way they worked. And it's very self-serving. And it's usually, I'm right and everybody else is wrong. I've been doing this thing right. No, you haven't. Because God blesses everyone who does it right with the same outcome. The same blessings. And the beautiful thing of it is he's so dedicated to us getting it right. It doesn't matter how long it takes us to find out how wonderful it is to come into this place called prayer. Hallelujah. Where the Spirit of the living God flows over you and overwhelms you in such a way. And really so much a part of this is about, are you willing to surrender everything? Are you willing to just, with total abandonment, say, "Lord, I'm yours." Hallelujah. I guess one of the things that preoccupied my life today more than anything else is, "Oh, God, use me more. Lord, I want to be used. Lord, whatever grace you pour upon me, it will not be given unto me in vain. I will run and labor with everything that is within me." And the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Son, produces these things. And so we talk about the Spirit of the Son. That's what the Holy Ghost is producing within us, because he's developing us and maturing us to function in all the ministry of the only begotten Son, Christ Jesus. And every time you go to prayer, that's what that's an opportunity to do. It's not an opportunity for you, you know, to repent and to, you know, try to pray for everybody that needs prayer and to, you know, what all these other things we're trying to do, which is, you know, I mean, bless your heart. I mean, it's a start, but come on. Papa wants a sotapananaya post. He wants to raise the kingdom Mickey unto the Bukanaya. Holy Spirit wants to make intercession for us. Think about this. Jesus defines the meaning of his existence to pray for you. I'll say it again. Jesus defines the meaning of his existence to pray for you and for me. He said, for he ever liveth to make intercession for the saints. That is to say, he defines the meaning of his life. Well, Jesus, don't you have any better things to do?
Thank you, Jesus.
Praying for Michael and... See, there's something about prayer that we've not understood. Jesus was always going and doing it. Whew. Jesus was always in the prayer getting a download from heaven because it was an interaction with heaven. It was a time for the Holy Ghost to flow, the things of the Spirit to be uninterrupted in the flow. Hallelujah. I used to, when I was young, I'd hear preachers preach about how that you're not going to have powerful faith without powerful faith. You're not going to have powerful faith without powerful prayer, and you're not going to have powerful prayer without powerful fasting. And I found that it's actually easier than that, but I'm not going to slight that because I started there. I'd fast a minimum of 2 days out of every week. I lived my life through that. I lived my life that way for years. I mean, I have, you know, somebody said, I just can't even believe it. Well, I have an eyewitness, go ask her, you know. And I just lived my life that way. Why? I went in prayer. I believe that. I read everything E.M. Bounds wrote. I read everything that Tozer wrote, that Andrew Murray wrote. I read all these different things on prayer from the great men of prayer, Charles Finney. And just, every time I read it, it's like, oh, God, I want that in my life. I want the things of the Spirit in my life. It wasn't the prayer that I wanted in my life. I wanted the results. I wanted the activity, the flow, the glory. I wanted to understand what would cause a man to go and crawl up inside of a log and stay there and pray and cry out to God till a visitation come out of the log, because he just shut himself in with God. He said, I'm not seeing anything, knowing anything but you, and I'm going to stay right here, care how many bugs are here until the power of God, until you do something, and he rises up and he shakes the nations of the earth. I mean, I read things like that and go, my goodness gracious, I'm going to do this. But, you know, the Lord taught me more about prayer, but it was in this context, and you can't take out the context. It's the hunger, the passion, the desperation. The Lord taught me more about prayer, you know, in terms of just him coming to me relationally and beginning to help me understand how good it was to be in his presence. Are you listening to me? Now, I can take you, if you would let me, past all these things, but you've got to learn how to hook up with the anointing, and I'm not going to minister on that sermon tonight. I'm going to tell you right now, that doesn't happen by accident. That happens purposefully. And there's all kinds of challenges and things that will come out to try to disconnect you or to prevent you from hooking up. And so you're going to have to work that out. You're going to have to get hungry enough to say, what does it take for me to connect? I want to connect with you, God, but I don't want to connect with anybody else. Ain't going to work. I want to connect you with you, God, but I want to connect with the church. That ain't going to work. Ain't going to work. That's not the way you set it up. So you're going to have to understand that. You got to get hungry enough. I got hungry enough to understand it. I think that when you get hungry enough to understand it, and you begin to search in the Word, then all of a sudden somebody starts preaching that's giving you revelation after revelation. It just bows you over. You're going, whoa. I believe, on the other hand, many people that aren't hungry, they never asked the question. They never sought it out. And they're just sitting there listening. Oh, interesting. It's logical. Seems important. But you don't know how. You have no place to put it. You have no place to activate it in your life. I want you to activate prayer in your life. Recognize it's an opportunity to stand in his presence. It's an opportunity to just begin to let him flow through you. And those of you who have been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in the language of the Spirit, hallelujah, letting God, the Holy Ghost, letting God speak through you. Listen, and that's pretty much, I think, everybody here tonight. You're so far down the road. Praise God. Now all you got to do is be willing to hear. All you got to do is hear Paul say, with all prayer and supplication, pray with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Yes. And understand that he's saying to us, as he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, that praying in the Spirit is praying in the Holy Ghost in a language that is unknown. It is unknown. In a language that is unknown, speaking out unknown things. Hallelujah. But what will happen is that any person that is given to the reality of this, you will immediately begin to pray out things with a great passion that you didn't have before when you go into the prayer list. You didn't have before when you were just awkwardly trying to figure out what you're supposed to be praying about. All of a sudden, there's this thunderous thing coming out of you. It's just effortless, and it's strong, and it's overwhelming, and it's got you, man. And you know, man, you just took it. This feels good. This ain't hurting your throat. This ain't attacking your brain. You ain't thinking about another thing to say. It's just flowing out of you. That is the exhale right there. That is the same as prophecy right there. That's it. And sometimes it can be interpretation of tongues, but there's unique things about it. Hallelujah, God, the Holy Ghost will teach you. And I can model for you, and I model it every time I stand in the pulpit. It's not like, well, you know, hang out, man. You never know when it's going to happen, but about once every 2 or 3 months, I do this. It's every meeting. This is how I live. I gave myself over to God in a such way, I said, Lord, I don't want to speak my own thing. I put my notes away a long time ago. There's nothing wrong with notes. You need to start somewhere, okay? I put my notes away a long time ago. I put my notes away sometime around 1986 or 1987. That was quite a few years ago. And I put my notes away because the Lord said, I want to take you to another level. That's how people that allow me to mentor them, for example, my wife, she was, I mean, bless her heart, her ministry was good, and it was always a blessing, and it was always fruitful when she's ministering from her notes. One day I took her notes away. I said, you can't have your notes. She said, what do you mean I can't have my notes? I said, you just can't have them. And she was upset. She is already having butterflies, but now she's got them big. I said, no. Don't have them. And she, I watched what she did. You know what she did? You know what she did? Guess what she did? Huh? She went and memorized every verse of scripture. I said, that's fine, baby, that's fine. Just you can't have the notes. Now let God, the Holy Ghost, speak. And she's standing. I remember that first time I saw her beaming. We were in Medellin. We were in Medellin, Mexico. We were ministering 3,000 people or so. And her face was radiant. I mean, it was bright. I took a picture of it the other day. I'm not kidding. I'll just brag a little bit. I took a picture the other day of three people. She was one of them. Everybody was standing in the same place. Two of the people's face had shadows on it because it was in the shade. Her face was glowing. It does. Look at her. She glows. She does. She's in a realm. She just lives in a realm. She lives in a realm. You know, I'll watch her come down from her prayer room at different times in the day. I watch her come down. I was busy doing some things on the computer. She came down. She had tears in her eyes. I know where she'd been. She'd been up in heaven. You know, it's a beautiful thing where you just shut every, because now you've gone from a prayer time to the call of prayer. Hallelujah. There's a great transition. Yeah. It's a great transition. So she had her prayer time, but now she transitioned into a call to prayer. Yeah. So it doesn't matter if I'm doing this thing, that thing, the other thing. I'm going to respond to the call of prayer. There were times in my life where I was working. I just went out and sat in the car. I need, because it was a call to prayer. I go sit in the car 10, maybe 15 minutes. Sometimes it was less, but it was a call to prayer. It usually wasn't less than 10 minutes. A call to prayer. And it's a thunderous thing. And my, what's happening? Changes are taking place. Changes are taking place in my life because I'm allowing God, the Holy Ghost, free course in my life. But changes are taking place 10,000 miles away. Things are taking place right in my home, in the spot where I'm at. I'm not in a frustration anymore. I've cast all my cares upon Him. I'm living like a child in the Father's house. Hallelujah. As a son. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so, Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and you need to show this to people that maybe ask you about these things. He says, I would that all of you speak in tongues. Very important verse. I want all of you to speak in tongues. You see that? Verse 5? I want all of you to speak in tongues. And also that you prophesy. Okay? But I don't want to jump to the prophesy because the people that don't speak in tongues don't prophesy either. So stop. And many of the people who speak in tongues don't prophesy. So stop. And tonight, that's what I'm about. I'm really just trying to help you to make this transition. And if you're feeling bad about yourself and your progress and you're feeling like a real big loser or whatever, you know, you're not going to get nothing. Because the doubtful and the unbelieving and the wavering and the double-minded person not getting anything from the Lord. You just got to get past that. So I said, how do I pull down the strong imaginations that make me feel so like I should be more than what I am right now? By just giving thanks to the Father for all the good things that He's done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That you have the life in Christ Jesus, the only begotten Son, that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's greater. Having my name written in the Lamb's Book of Life is greater than casting out all the devils that ever existed in any human being. Anyways, doing every miracle you can ever possibly think of. Because you can do every miracle you can possibly think about and not necessarily have your name written or in the books, Lamb's Book of Life, or potentially lose it. And I tell you right now, if you're excited about having your name in the Lamb's Book of Life every day, you're going to stay in there.
Yes.
Right? It's going to stay in there. You're not going to get distracted of who you are and what you did and all your accomplishments. Because the Lord isn't going to count how many, He's not counting how many dollars you gave in the offering. He's not going to count how many souls you won. He's not going to count how many hours spent. He's not going to count all these things. He's going to count about the relationship you have with Him. Now, the relationship you have with Him is going to have an outworking. It's going to have an outworking. You know, and some people, it takes them a long time to grow up. But Father's got long suffering. So you're in good hands. But the Lord says in verse 18, He said, Paul said, I would that you all speak in tongues. So somebody says anything different, just say, well, Paul said he wanted everybody to speak in tongues. And in verse 18, he said, I speak in tongues more than y'all. So he's bragging about it. Are you listening to me? He got everybody in the room, I speak in tongues more than you all. Amen.
Amen.
But he's making a point. I want to speak also things that people can understand. But he's not going to speak out of his head. He's not speaking out of his head. Because he said in verse 6, if I come to you speaking in tongues, what should it profit you unless I speak out of the spiritual overflow of those tongues?
Yeah.
And that's really what it is. It's a spiritual overflow of those tongues. When he talks about it, unless I give you by prophecy, or rather by revelation, by knowledge, by prophecy, or by doctrine. Who taught Paul his doctrine?
Holy Spirit.
Holy Ghost. Yeah. Hallelujah. So, I mean, it's just real simple, because I see people twist these things. I say, oh, well, Paul, he said, those 10,000 words. I mean, give me a break. What is he really saying? He's already laid the foundation. This is the best thing going, people. This is what is absolutely essential. What are we going to do then? We're going to pray in the Spirit or pray in tongues and pray with the understanding also. What are you talking about, the understanding? Now it's your turn. Holy Ghost, you go first. Then it's my turn. No, he's talking about an excelling. The whole point, you know, in 1 Corinthians 14 is about excelling. Going from the utterances of the Holy Ghost in the unknown to the utterances of the Holy Ghost to the known. to pray in a way that you don't understand and your intellect is unfruitful to a place to where that you do understand and your intellect is fruitful. And so don't listen to people who try to tell you what 1 Corinthians 14 means and they've never stepped into this realm. Hello. Because people who live in theory never really get the practice of it out anyways. These things you got to experience. See, God's experience. Somebody says, I don't believe that. Well, God wants you to know a love that passes knowledge. Hallelujah. That means you got to experience it. Hallelujah. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, you got to experience it. God's given us experiences. Hallelujah. The new birth is an experience. It's an impartation. It's an experience. Give me a break. Everybody wants to talk about imputation and this thing, that thing. Well, let people just talk. Because some of you because it's really a mess of this stuff comes right out of a spirit of strife. It's strife and insecurity. And if you had a snapshot of their life, it's messed up. I guarantee you, listen to me. It's true. I've been around watching this go on for a long time. You show me people who are flowing the Holy Ghost and know the things of God, they're very secure. And I go, you're not going to catch them in an argument. And I'm about the Word of God, especially. I'm going to catch them in living in strife. They're just going to say, okay, fine, whatever. Why? Because I don't need to get in strife. I'm being taken care of by God. I don't need to fight about anything. I don't need to fight over having something from you. Huh? Your approval or whatever else. I got God. Your agreement, whatever. I got God. I'm just going to lay out here for you the things the Father's made real to me. And more than just made real to me, but that you can see and read right there in print. Hallelujah. It is amazing. I mean, I tell you right now, I am a phenomenon to the church because I get up and preach and just quote scripture. And it is a sad thing, but I am a phenomenon. Hands down, by witnesses all over, I'm a phenomenon. I get up and preach, and I just quote scripture after scripture after scripture after scripture, and I stay right with the Word of God. Huh? And I take that, and then I begin to utilize that to sort out people where you are missing it, because you're not going to have this with that going on. You're not going to mature unless this adjustment is made. And then everybody said, oh, now you're doing wrong. Now you've gone to meddling. No. I've gone to being a pastor. Hallelujah. I might have made a transition from living just prophetically. Hallelujah. Because to speak prophetically, to speak as a prophet, is to speak the Word of God. To be a false prophet is to speak something that's not declared in the Word of God. You hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
To be a prophet is to declare those things which are in the Word of God and speak them in such a way that they're revelatory. That's basically the definition of a prophet. With that, there is the foretelling of the future as God gives the insight. But the bigger point of it is to make known what God wants people to do right now. Huh? And He also makes known through that what's the consequences if you don't do it.
Yes.
And what's the consequences if you do it. And He also makes known what He's going to be doing, whether you do anything or not. That's the other dimension of it. And that's a beautiful thing too, because we can have that. The Holy Ghost has come to show us what the future looks like. Isn't it beautiful?
Yes.
And then I believe it is, it's either verse 31 or verse 35. I'm trying to see it. I think it's verse 35. And it says, forbid not to speak with tongues. Hello. You hear me?
Yes.
If you just walk out of here tonight, 5, 18, and 35.
39.
You just walked out of here with those verses of Scripture, you'd be armed against all the Holy Ghost fighters and those who would try to be anointing thieves. Huh? You can steal anything I got. You can have it, but you can't have my anointing. You have to get your own. Hallelujah. You come steal my truck. I mean, goodness gracious. Come steal my lamp. Have it. But the anointing thieves. Everybody I've ever known walking, function, flowing in the anointing. As soon as there's people in the building who've got wrong attitudes and wrong spirits, if they're Christians, and especially if they've got critical things going on in their spirit, they'll start screaming and hollering until that thing's either shut down with the body or without the body. Why? Because Holy Ghost is so agreed by it, He ain't going to move, and somebody who's come to be dependent upon the Holy Ghost to minister is shut down till that's done. And that's a very awkward feeling. And we know what to do. People say, what's he ranting and raving about now? I'm just an average minister. And I'm wanting to excel into one that's above average to an excellent one. Amen.
Amen.
And I want you to understand, if you've got those attitudes going on in your life, you're going to shut the Holy Ghost down. I don't care where you're at, your living room, your car, your garage, your backyard, the church, you just grieve the Holy Ghost so bad. It's like, I'm here for you when you want me. You got some repenting to do. God and the Holy Ghost is never going to mix it up with the doubt and unbelief. We've got to understand how to separate those things out. Father's never going to hook up with the fear. The beautiful thing and the intimidation, the beautiful thing of it is the one who makes intercession for us according to the mind of the Spirit, according to the mind of Christ, according to the mind of God. You know what He's doing? He's helping our areas of weakness, where we've got this problem of murmuring and complaining, where we got this problem of fear and intimidation. He's helping us to just not to give place to it. But what happens if we keep going back to the thing He said not to go to? Huh? If you got gallbladder problems and you keep eating greasy pork chops, you're going to make it worse. You can't keep going back to that if you're starting to feel healed. Amen. Better. Well, the same way in the spirit. If the Lord shows you that thing that you're doing is polluting and infecting the things in the Spirit, it's stopping the flow of the Holy Ghost. Listen, some people go and pray, oh God, what have I done wrong if they're sick? And I understand that. Start searching your heart. I shouldn't be sick. What have I done wrong to be sick? Man, I'm telling you right now, you know where I really go to praying? Is it that the flow is not there. I'm going, Lord, Holy Spirit, I'm so sorry, where did I grieve you? I'll meet it right there. I don't have to go through no list. Because if there's not a flow, I've grieved the Holy Ghost. It wasn't anybody else. It wasn't my brother, it wasn't my sister, but it's me, oh Lord. Okay? My mother used to say, I'm just so depressed by all these people going and cleaning everybody's back porch when theirs is piled up knee high. You know? Come on, you know what I'm saying? And it's just so amazing. People who are preoccupied with everybody else's problems are those who are unwilling to view their own. And always have a stack of them. Okay? Amen. It's true. Because when it's about you being faithful to the Father and you stepping into that relationship that He has for you and you just enjoying His manifest presence, I'm telling you, there's times like Wednesday night, I get home and I'm like, oh Lord, please, please help me. I don't ever want to lose this anointing. I don't ever want to lose this anointing. I don't ever want to lose this glory. Please, please help me. Please, Lord. I'm desperate about it. It's the worst possible thing I could imagine. And then I get up in the morning, oh Lord, strengthen me. Please help me. Holy Spirit, I'm going to be so sensitive to you because I don't want to lose any of this anointing. It's a beautiful thing to step into a room and immediately have the mantle of His presence come upon you. Huh? For ministry. It's a beautiful thing to be talking on the telephone, have the same glory to come upon you. It's a beautiful thing to begin to pray, have the same kind of glory come upon you. It's an amazing thing to have the glory come upon you and you're just staying in that realm. Just staying in that realm. Because you've learned, oh, if I do that, it's going to shut down. It's going to shut down things. One of the reasons that I wanted to have the meeting for children's ministry here tonight in this context after this meeting so that everybody can understand a transition in the Spirit. Because people go mental. It immediately creates a transition in the Spirit and the flow will go away. When that begins to happen in your life and you begin to recognize it about your own life, then suddenly you recognize, I don't want to participate with that. I don't want to sit here and try to figure out for God what He needs to do. I don't want to be a person taking up God's slack. I don't want to be disinterested with the things of the kingdom. All that, it impacts. It impacts the freedom of the Holy Ghost. He's a perfect gentleman. He's not forcing nothing on us. As soon as we turn our hearts towards other things, He's a heart guy. As soon as we turn our hearts towards other things, it begins to subside. His flow, His glory. It's not like that the Holy Ghost has come upon you and lifted off. It's the fact of it is that you and I turn our attention away from Him and He backs off, as it were. He's not the dominant, as it were, impact upon what we're doing. He wants to be building up yourself in your most holy faith. Whew. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Is one of the ways, tools, that the Holy Spirit uses to teach us to always be flowing in the glory. Whew. Hallelujah. Being filled with the Spirit is the same thing as being putting on the Lord Jesus Christ. Or being endued with the Lord Jesus Christ is like the way I like to say it. It's the same, being filled with the Spirit is the same as walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As I'm day right now, I know some people who aren't born again and they walk in the Word in every outward form and expression that you can see, Orthodox Jews, but they're not doing it by the Spirit. They're not walking in the Spirit. I'm talking about a literal, living reality of what the Holy Ghost brings. Manifest presence. Whew. Hallelujah. 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 Harobongandeshi. Halobondombrasaya. Hale me kendo borasita. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And then towards the end of the chapter, well, I thought for sure that I would that you all, you are forbid not to speak with tongues was more toward, I guess that is the end. But towards the end of the chapter, Paul makes a rhetorical statement. And I believe, I guess I would have to, you know, back up to chapter 12. He says they'll all speak with tongues. Right? Huh? It's chapter 12, isn't it? And it, huh? Just answer me yes or no. Okay, chapter 12. And it would be approximately verse 31, 32. Where is it at? 29? Chapter 29. It says, and 30's in there too. So he begins to go through the gifts and he begins to ask a rhetorical question, do all do these things? Well, the obvious answer is no. But at the same time, all can do these things, and it's the will of God for all to do these things.
Amen.
Because he's given us the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He's given us an unlimited supply of the anointing. We've been endued with power from on high. And the only reason that you would not all do these things is because you've not grown and mature into the fullness of the measure of maturity of the ministry of Jesus. Hello?
Yes.
There's still people that just got saved. They ain't not been baptized in the Holy Ghost yet.
Right.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Do we know that it's the will of God to baptize everybody in the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Well, absolutely. He poured out His Spirit upon all flesh, Acts chapter 2. I just need to help people rehearse these things.
Yes.
And if you rehearse them in your heart, in your mind, then when the anointing thieves come to try to steal away from you your confidence in God, you'll be able to just say, you know, that just really isn't the way it is. And if you'd like to understand more, I'd be happy to tell you. And then as soon as they want to start arguing about this thing and that thing, say, well, you know what, we're just done here. God loves you and He wants to bless you more, and I hope you get hungry. It's just because that's the way I deal with it. Someone started arguing, you know, it's fine. I just go, it's fine, no problem. I usually end it like that. That's fine, no problem. It's okay. And you know, then they got to try to go and explain themselves. So tara masikita be at the level. You know, it's that one way to end a conversation quickly with someone who believes the tongues are of the devil. I mean, you know, and they go, woo! And just start really getting in, man, where there's an expression of divine glory and just whoa! And it's all real. That was all real. None of that was makeup, please. Because I'll tell you right now, just hang around and watch what really happens when I get carried away. I mean, I'm at the point of almost flying and wish I could. Woo, because every cell of your body is infected. I'm just keeping on being sober. You know, I pull on my shirt, remind myself I'm being sober. I'm trying to not dance as hard anymore and trying to make myself more tolerable to the human mind that the Word of God may find entrance. Ha! Don't mean I'm not going to stop dancing. Don't mean I'm going to stop, you know, hallelujah, jerking around, shaking under the power of God. Huh? Just, I could control myself. I love to see Allie come under the anointing. Her whole body's trembling. I think her toenails are trembling and fingernails trembling. Everything's trembling. Hallelujah. And you know, you know, I'm saying all these things because it's about growth. It's about maturity. It's about excelling. And you can't just tolerate not excelling. And if you didn't have a way to hook up with the anointing to where that flow could be supplied to you, well, that would be one thing. You're not in a Methodist church. You're hooked up in a place. You've got to deal with why you're not hooked up, because this should immediately start happening in your life. Paul describes it in Ephesians. He describes Jesus as the head, and he describes the connectivity that flows from the head to every joint and every part and every member. And you just got to understand, if you're, you know, on your own independent finger floating around, which belongs for Halloween, not to the body of Christ, or a foot, the foot. I'm so blessed, I'm the foot. Nobody's interested. We're interested in the whole body. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's easy to receive these things. Somebody said, how did she step into it so easily? God said, she just hooked up. How she gets so hooked up? Because she's just in love. She sees as many problems as you do. She's just not bothered by them.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
She's just not in mental with it or in her head about it. Come on, think about it. Think about it, people. Oh, there's a glory realm to live in, a place where God covers you with His glory, fills you with His, what He feels. And then you just, why the man, you just going to receive. You're just a yielded vessel now. You just yield it. Woo! You just, and everything is coming from heaven. You're just receiving it. And then any area in my life where I'm not just receiving, I'm letting God, the Holy Spirit, strengthen me and build me up. And I'm maturing so that I can begin to receive even more of that which He's supplying. You know, Ann said to me today, she said, honey, I really want to go to Israel. When are we going to Israel? I said, we're going to Israel when the signs and the wonders and the miracles that God's going to do through our lives is at an impact, at such a level that will impact the Orthodox Jews, because I have that day appointed unto me. I have that day appointed unto me. It will happen. You know, a lot of people walk through the process of relationship with the Lord and they get offended. They get shut down because things didn't work out the way they wanted it to work out. I've learned now not to get offended. I'm looking at the vision. I got a heavenly vision. I'm looking at Him. I'm enjoying this. How can you get disappointed when you're just having so much fun? I'm enjoying the presence of the Lord. Huh? Hallelujah. I don't know what your problems are. I don't know what your issues are. Some of them I do. I don't want to lie about it. I know that the two biggest challenges is the realm of self and demonic powers. There's nothing else to stand between you and God. So if you're having a problem, I can tell you it's one or two. Flip a coin. They're almost equal anyways. They're almost equal. They're not entirely. We have to deny ourselves. And if we don't, it ain't going to be long. Satan's going to get involved in that, and he's going to really begin to do some manipulating. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 is about excelling. Yes. It's about maturing. You know, the Lord gave Ruth Ann a vision the other day, and she prophesied out of it. I put it up on my Facebook. And some of the things that really stood out to me, because I heard so strongly the Lord speaking in it, so, you know, where so many people are offended by the Holy Ghost. They're offended at God, blaming God. They're offended at revival. Well, I've been hearing about revival so long now. I mean, come on, what's this, another dose of whatever? You know, no, I'm not kidding you. People are offended by revival. Oh, yeah, you told us that last time. Yeah, I can see you're really flowing in the anointing. I see the impacts it had on your life. And it's gotten so convoluted with the offense, they don't know how to move on in the things of a spirit. The one thing you don't want to do is be ashamed or embarrassed by the Holy Ghost. The one thing you want, because that's going to work absolutely opposite. You want to be so blessed by Him. You know, the Holy Spirit is here. He's here with us. Jesus is personally in heaven. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Although He's in me, no one's going to heaven without Christ in them. They say, I believe in Jesus. Well, is Jesus in you? Because you're not making heaven unless Jesus is in you. Are you living the life of Jesus? Because you're not making heaven unless you're living the life of Jesus. I don't care what you know. It doesn't matter. Living the life of Jesus. And that's what the Holy Ghost is coming to teach us how to do. The Lord Jesus personally, however, though is in heaven, the Holy Ghost is personally here. He's God. Recognizing Him, participating with Him, honoring Him, doing the things that He's supplied for us to do. When He came, the thing that He supplied for us to do as our teacher, as our mentor, the first expression of the rivers is the language of the Spirit. And the language of the Spirit must be allowed to develop into the expressions that men can know. And I'm going to tell you this. I don't believe that it is developed any other place than first talking to the Father.
Amen.
Just as we see the expression in Acts chapter 2, the expression, there's the language. And where did it develop? It didn't develop in talking to people. It developed in talking to God. And all of them heard in their own language. Then, what did they hear? They heard them praising the Lord, giving thanks, and praising Him for His wonderful works. Hallelujah. And then it'd take you over to the wonderful works psalm, you know? Oh, that men would praise the Lord for His wonderful works. And to us, the children of men. If that's Tokiana Siki Tokona Makachia Kana Makia to Kambosapan de Beya, Sibera Natagina Mesapolanamonkadeya is not the only sound of tongues in my life. Have you ever noticed that?
Yes.
There are many expressions of tongues. And the Holy Ghost gives the utterance. Right now, I'm in a language tongue. That's a language tongue. It's a language tongue to be interpreted. It is a language tongue that off of that springs board prophecy and off of that springs board's doctrine. There is a praying tongue. There is a singing tongue. Just listen. We express these things all the time. Don't sit there and look at me like, you gotta be kidding me. Like this is something new. We do this 3 times a week. I mean, if you've only been here for a couple of months, I can understand the kind of awkward look. Really? But if you've been here for more than a year, it's just being modeled for you all the time. Then you have to say, well, why don't I do that? Then you have to begin to deal with it. Do you follow the leader? Are you an independent person? Are you willing to follow those who follow Christ? Are you willing to be taught of God? Do you realize that a lot of what God's going to teach you, He's going to teach you to the ones that He placed in His church? If you don't believe that God sent in the church apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, then you probably aren't going to be able to benefit. Well, I know you won't. You will not be able to benefit from the gifts of the Spirit that He placed in the church, which tongues and interpretation of tongues and prophecy are a part. Because He set them in the church. They are there. They are here right now functioning. They are imparted. They are ministered. They are received. They are received fundamentally through the Word of God and by the Spirit of God, by connectivity. You grow and mature in them by use. Make sense? Hallelujah. Stuka ramanje is to pirinasa. Tando lopo kanase is to pirinisti pikinda tande. Esiporanaya is as much a part of my life in preaching as it is as just speaking words that can be understood. Istiparana mambredeya payanasusta is a part of my life in laying hands on the sick and ministering the things of the Spirit, which are already resident here. They're here. They're available, working of miracles. Whew. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to be able to begin to realize as you give yourself to allowing the Holy Ghost to flow through you, I want you to begin to realize, don't force it. You don't try to make it happen. You're not sitting there anticipating, okay, when is it going to happen? Okay, is it happening yet? Because that's all head. That's all mental. You got to forget that. Is working your life. You just begin to imagine, if you would, or just begin to wait on the Lord in, as you're going there, that there, it's not going to be long and there's going to be a breakout of prayer. How many have experienced that? That's good, because everybody should have experienced that. People, I want you to understand this. The interpretation of tongues and prophecy works exactly the same way. It just becomes more integrated. For me, it's almost like, you know, the other day I was really noticing this. It's almost like because I just wanted to describe it to you. I want you to be able to profit from it. I want you to be able to recognize it when you see it. I was just praying in a language that someone could just define as me building myself up. And I don't, you know, it's not a language. That's not an interpretation language. It's not a preaching language. It's a building up language. I was there. And then all of a sudden it began to develop. I was in a meeting where everybody was praying. And then it began to develop even to a greater way. And it's all in the hands of the Spirit. It's all in the hands of the Holy Ghost. And see, that's right in the same, that's interpretation of tongues. See, Akadamosiyantalama begins to be mixed up with words. I can't even speak in English. I'm speaking in the tongue. And then I get a word or two in edgewise, as it were, right? It's where the tongues and the interpretation of tongues are being integrated. I'm not trying to make this an intellectual thing for you. I'm just trying to help you understand how close they are, because I've watched this happen over and over again. I've watched people sit there and just mentally say, okay, what is it that we're supposed to be saying? Oh God, what is it that you're saying? That's a mental realm. And then here it comes. Oh God, he's high and lifted up. He's God, and you are people. Amazing. And he loves you, and he loves you dearly. And he's coming soon. And then if you have the interpretation of the tongue, you're going, bless your heart. I mean, good try. I mean, all of it was good. They weren't messing up things, you know. At least they were saying Jesus isn't coming. At least they were getting it. They were getting their predictions right. People put everybody there. But, you know, you've been praying like that, right? You know, you understand that. Everybody in here probably understands that. And you begin to break into this thunderous inspiration in tongues, right? The interpretation will come just the same way. It'll be just as thunderous. It'll be just as real. It'll just be just the same flow. And does it have to be like, you know, perfect Elizabethan English? Yea, ye, thou, thee? No. And does it have to be, does it have to be, you know, just uninterrupted, perfect sentences? That's not choppy at all? No. It's the inspiration. Hallelujah. And you feel it in the atmosphere, don't you? No one's dropping their head feeling real awkward. Because it's captivating. You know, people are dropping their head feeling really awkward. You know, it's time to just kind of bring it to a close. Let me say this. I believe that one of the greatest places that we are privileged to see the development of tongues and interpretation of tongues is in singing. No one could hardly even hear you, unless you're just way out of key. In such cases, your gifting and calling is not music and singing. So sing a little lower. But I don't even put that on people, because I want everybody just to be totally unlimited. Go ahead, belt it out, because I can sing louder than you. God gave me those lungs. Hallelujah. And we can always turn the microphone up too. So, but at any rate, that's a beautiful thing about saying, well, you know what? When I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 14, what should we do then? After Paul's given all of his correction, laid it all out there. We know this is good. We already got the correction. We already laid it all out there. Don't have the home meeting. But I believe every meeting should start that way. And I'm so blessed when I come in, it sounds like a wind down here, because people, sounds like a rushing mighty wind, because people praying in the Holy Ghost. But he said, what shall we do then? We'll pray in the Spirit and we'll sing in the Spirit. So anytime you hear Paul talk about praying in the Spirit, you know exactly what he's talking about. Or Jude, anyone else. He's praying in an unknown tongue. And we will sing in the Spirit and sing in an unknown tongue. So here we are. Think about it, dear people. Prayer. Revelation. Prayer. Wow, this is why Pastor believes this is developed in prayer. Woo! Revelation. Are you with me?
Yep.
Hello?
Yes.
So if you're not going to develop in prayer, where you praying, where you're on a daily basis praying, you know what? Here's something that I want to step into. in a greater way. I want to step into praying in a greater way with the understanding by the Holy Ghost at least 3 times a day with the understanding, the outburst of praise and thanksgiving to the Lord in a stronger way. I'm giving myself that. I want it. I got to go. I want that. And you're going to have to be willing to participate with these types of goals. Otherwise, you're never going to understand the joy of it, the beauty of it, because you've never given yourself to it. It's something that you've got to allow the Holy Ghost to have free course in your life. If you'll do it, all of a sudden, when you're getting ready to face the temptation, tongues will hit you. All of a sudden, if you need to be built up because it's like it's all as though something happened or you were compromised or something, Holy Ghost immediately, like a governor, steps in and the tongues begin to flow. Men, now, look at how kept you are by the power of God in this. The spiritual activity of the Holy Ghost leading us, guiding us, showing us how to depend upon Him so we don't have to try to figure it out. So we don't have to tie strings on our fingers. Bind them upon our hearts, our arms, and wear upon our frontlets, as a frontlet upon our forehead, the phylacteries. Huh? I'm bound to the Spirit. I'm bound to the Word by the Spirit. Praying. What am I doing? I'm going to pray what? Huh? I'm going to pray what?
In the Spirit.
And with the?
Understanding.
Is that revelation to you? Or has you already got that? I believe it's revelation to you. So don't sit there and stir just in your halo there. Act like you already knew it. You may have known it, but I'm talking about revelation. I'm talking about having it.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because it's not in the context of the church only. And it's more actually, in the context of your personal life if it's going to be in the context of the church. And it is in the context of the church. How many people can pray in church? Well, change your doctrines then. There you go. You listen to me. Hallelujah. Everybody's supposed to be praying. How's the house of prayer? Hello. Can't be speaking in tongues in church. You're praying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And singing. How many people got to sing? One at a time. It'd be indecent out of order if everybody sang at once. Really? As they say in Japan, oh, really? And guys, in Japan, I love you very dearly. And praise God for the people in Japan watching this faithfully all the time with us. I love them. I'm coming to Japan. Japan's so important to me. God's made it so important to me. See, I'm preparing for big things in God. You might be preparing for little things in God, thus you give Him little participation. You might not be preparing for anything in God, thus you don't do anything. But I'm preparing for great things in God, thus I'm not waiting the last minute. Oh, no, we better get ready now because we're getting ready to have a great outpouring of God's Spirit upon an entire nation. Ain't time to get ready now. The only people going to be used are those who've been prepared. The people who so long ago had a vision. Long ago it was touched by the revelation that this is what God wanted to do with your life. God wants to do great things with your life. And when you begin to realize it, then you'll begin to prepare in a great way. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praying in the Spirit, praying in the understanding also. What is that? That's excelling to what? The unknown. To the known. Speaking mysteries in the Spirit. Hallelujah. To now unveiling mysteries by the Spirit.
Yes.
You hear that?
Yes.
Same way with singing. Yes. The Lord Jesus used to write many songs. People say, how do you do that? By the Holy Ghost. And it usually always starts as tongues.
Yes.
And maybe people laugh because they got affinities. They're singing in the tongues. And they laugh just before the song that they could understand came out. They left. They got offended. They cut off God's supply to their life, an encounter with the beauty of the operation of the Holy Ghost because of offense. So there's so many constant declarations and witnesses to all of us on a daily basis of those things that would get in the way. Identify them and don't let them get in the way anymore. Just walk over here in love. If you walk in love and humility, you're protected against about everything Satan possibly could throw at you.
Yeah.
Huh? If you walk in love as dear children and you're willing to be clothed with humility, I'm telling you right now, Satan can't get in anyway. Hallelujah. And I'm, you know, and the beautiful thing about it, as we do these things, as we pray in the Holy Ghost, this, and we keep ourselves in love with God, same way with humility, same way with kindness, same way with goodness, same way with the gift of faith. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is such a wonderful privilege to be over here in abundant life. Lambda say ati ani si. Hallelujah. Hana mangede na mandeya sita. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The things of the Spirit will become so much greater to you than anything else in this life. And it will be your strength and your power to overcome every adversity, every temptation Satan throws at you, everything that would beset you or hold you back. That's why it's so important for you to learn how to enjoy the presence of the Lord. That is why it's so essential. Listen, the overcomer is the one that steps in. God makes it the most important thing for you and me. The one who overcomes will sit down with me in my throne, even as I sat down with my Father in his throne. This is the faith that overcomes the world, overcoming the world, overcoming those things which Satan would try to place upon our life and get us to participate with. The most important thing today, men have wrongly, have in a terrible way violated the Word of God and the Spirit of God by teaching men that they can live in sin more or less every day and live right with and be right with God. And that is so such a violation, for it strips from them the knowledge of the Lord, the strength of the Lord, and the resolve of the Lord. So, dear people, take up those things which the Spirit of the Lord has made available to you, so that He can build you up and make you strong in the things that belong to the kingdom, that you may be able to go forth by Him and allow Him to use you in a way that heaven's rain will be rain, both the R-E and the R-I. Heaven's rain will be experienced in the people's life that have been held back and kept back from the beauty of what it means to live this life in Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Kato kana se ki kana mokatata. Hesa perineshi. And so we'll pray. We'll sing. Both in the Spirit. And with the understanding by the Spirit. And we'll prophesy. Every meeting. And everybody can join in. And the more you, just think about it, the more you participated, the more you got carried away in the worship, the stronger the meeting was for you. Yeah. The greater the anointing. I just give myself to always get in. Yeah. Why? Because I've gotten rid of all the distractions. My heart's single. My eyes single. How'd I get that? I gave myself to the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And He built me up. And He prayed for me. And He interceded for me in the areas of my weakness and made me strong. Hallelujah. He gave me, he built me up in faith so that doubt wouldn't be there, constantly having influence in my life and unbelief. He built me up in thanksgiving so I wouldn't be complaining. Hallelujah. Do the same. Just do it. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Whew. Feel like laying hands on everybody in the place.
Yeah.
And I know the Holy Spirit's laying hands on you. Because He lays hands on you by His moving. He lays hands on you by His Word. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.